our leaders in the church back in 1922 begin to write in their, especially the annual address of the General Overseer, wrote a section on what was then called our colored people. That term is not used anymore. But he was very concerned about the fact that they needed to feel at home in the church, they needed to have a place in the church. So they had a leader set up, and he would be working with the General Overseer and leading the African American work across the country. They were not everybody felt good about that, because they didn't want to make such clear distinctions as to have a black church and a white church.
Right.
But in 1923, at the restart, and I think in 24 actually in the assembly, they recognized that they wanted just to be together as one people, as one body. And obviously they had to face the Jim Crow laws that existed in many of these states around. And I want to say this, some of our white ministers who would travel with some of our black appointees, our black brothers were not allowed to stay at the same facility. Our white brothers said, we're not going to stay there. In other words, they made it was a live, practical protest to what was going on. And they would not allow our black brothers to eat, they would meet. Some of us from other parts of the world were appointed here at the International Office of the Church. And in the mid-80s or so, I guess, scholars begin to discover that this little group had a flavor in its international assembly and in its international leadership that represented what the gospel really should do, that we should be brothers together in this work. And scholars begin to write about the fact that the Church of God of Prophecy, though not so widely known, was actually a model for integration at that point. It doesn't say we did it exactly altogether perfectly, but it's a learning process, and we are growing as we do it. And so over the years, scholars have highlighted, even naming some of us who were up here in those years. I came up from the Virgin Islands in 1972, for example. I was appointed up here and think of a church based here in the South appointing a young black man from the Virgin Islands to be part of its international staff. I mean, that was not something that was commonly done or known. But eventually scholars begin to write about us, and I trust that through our maturing during the years, we will continue to do better. And we have internationals. If you look at our present general presbytership, we have a brother from Jamaica that's one of our presbyters. We have two brothers from the Dominican Republic that come from the mixed black race there. We have a brother from the United States who has become basically a convert to Germany. He's acclimated over there. He is on the General Presbytery. Of course, we have a North American presbyter who came from here in this area. We have a brother from Swaziland in Africa who is the African presbyter. So when you look at the mix, you know, on a worldwide basis, the church has really reflected and strived very much to reflect what the gospel calls for in Galatians 3:28. There's neither bond nor free, male nor female, we're all one in Christ. You know, neither Jew nor Gentile. So that is one of the things that I think our church has had an opportunity to begin to reflect. And as I said, we've not done it yet perfectly. We're not saying that we're perfect in all of these areas, but we are so grateful for what God has done and looking forward to what else He will do. We've changed quite a number of things, including our structure, and adjusted some of our doctrines to a more biblical stand on several things. And so I see the church going forward to its future, to reflect the call that Christ has on us. And I put it simply, the Lord wants us to be a model of what the church should be. And actually, our forefathers set out to do that way back in the restoration, what we call the restoration period. They were trying to be what they saw in the New Testament. Well, that's the same commitment we have today. But I believe the Spirit is pressing us to let the model be seen, not just talk and preached. We are an all-nations church. We have an all-nations message because the gospel is for everybody. And we are trying to reflect that as we practically live together as a community of people in the kingdom of God. So others in the kingdom can look at us and say, well, let's try to be and do it like them.